My guest this week here in Kiev is Stateless. He's a former president of Georgia, a former regional governor in Ukraine. And hanging over him, multiple allegations of criminal activity and a 3-year prison sentence for abuse of power. He's Mikheil Saakashvili, once the darling of the West for spearheading the Rose Revolution in Georgia in 2003. But has he now made too many enemies and run out of road? Mikheil Saakashvili, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Thank you for inviting me.
It's been a bizarre few weeks for you. One moment you're promising to unite the opposition against the president, then you're threatening to throw yourself off the roof of a block of flats.
Well, that's not exactly true. I didn't throw myself out. I told them...
You threatened to?
No, I told them if they come and try to put handcuffs off me, we would all fall. And that was actually the truth. And they never tried it at that place. But I went to the roof because my cell phone was jammed and I needed to call people. So I had to go to the roof. It had very pragmatic reason. Till the end, one first message got through at the edge of the roof. So that's how telecommunications work these days.
But this is street theater you're involved in. A lot of people are wondering whether you've lost the plot.
No, well, look, it's not about me. I think people have...
You made it about you, didn't you? Made it about you. You said I'm a prisoner of the oligarchs.
The government is doing all kind of bizarre things that in many ways is making it about me, because since 1 year they've been involved in all kind of manipulations to squeeze me out of Ukraine.
Yeah, but you scuffle with police, you insult the leaders, you cross an international border with an invalid passport. You're asking for it, aren't you?
Yeah, look, it all started from the fact that they re-registered my party on somebody else's name. Then they deprived me of nationality illegally. Then they didn't let me back illegally because I had valid document to enter Ukraine. At least I had right to be considered as an applicant.
But you didn't have to come back. They didn't force you to come back.
They obviously didn't want to come back,
yeah,
for
and
sure.
You wanted to come
I agree
back.
With that. But
because, another day, another stunt, isn't it?
No, I wanted to come back because I believe in the future of this country and I believe that I have a place in the future of this country. As simple as that. And these guys don't want me here, period.
But one moment you're screaming at the people to go out, take to the streets, throw out Poroshenko and the thieves, as you put it.
Yes.
And then you write him a letter saying, oh, it's nothing personal.
Yeah, it's nothing personal.
And let's have a chat.
It's nothing personal. I actually...
Bewildering array of mixed messages.
No. I actually made it very clear that I'm willing. It's nothing personal about me. It's not about Poroshenko per se. It's about the oligarch.
You called him a thief. That's pretty personal.
Yes, absolutely. The whole clique is clique of thieves. But it doesn't mean that
But apart from that, it's not personal.
And the only thing I made clear we would talk about the terms of transition, because this country needs transition. The country is in deep trouble. Ukraine might disintegrate, just fall apart if this whole thing continues. And I'm very worried about that.
But you're parading through the streets, wearing a flag and carrying a handcuff on one of your things. And you
No, that wasn't of my choice. That's they put it on me.
And you seem to revel in selfies. I'm the one who gets most of the selfies, you told a reporter.
Well, that's part of our job, as you know.
So you like being in the public eye. You're enjoying this enormously, aren't you?
Without public support, I cannot achieve much. The only thing that can keep me moving here, the only thing how we can achieve something here in the situation where legal system is failing, the institutions don't work, Ukraine basically is so far the state with absolutely failed institutions, the only way how we can get it through your message is through people.
But you seem desperate for publicity.
No, I'm desperate for result. Ukraine needs to be rescued. Ukraine is the biggest country in Europe, and it's right now failing.
But maybe it doesn't want to be rescued by you. I mean, a couple of years ago when you got here, your poll ratings were good. You claimed last August to be always among the 3 or 4 most popular politicians. But even here, that's not saying much these days, is it? A poll last September by the International Republican Institute showed that 70% of Ukrainians had either a somewhat unfavorable or very unfavorable view of you.
Let me say, Ukrainians right now hate all the politicians, but this is the poll from December. And from the poll in December, 33% of Ukrainians would support my candidacy for prime ministership. And actually, they supported more than half of them support more or less 46.
This is one poll, but there are plenty of other polls
that
show you only 2% giving you a very favorable rate.
No,
only 2%.
That's exactly absolutely not true.
This was the International Republican.
Yeah, that was maybe September, whatever. But
you think they see soil like that?
Their last poll, IRS last poll from December, from November, something like that, which is the latest poll that you mentioned, gave me exactly the same ratings as President Poroshenko. President Poroshenko was all around media, and I was absolutely
pretty unpopular.
Pretty unpopular. So that's not a big achievement, but considering
you set the bar pretty low.
Yeah, that's pretty low, but unfortunately. Most of Ukrainian politicians are there. But we've been, since we start this movement, since we actually really took up this flag of battle, we've been moving ahead. And my party is easily making it to parliament, despite the media blockage. As I said, 33% in this poll are supporting my candidates for prime minister. And basically, people are supporting our agenda. And that's more important than personal support.
Well, you say that, and you insisted to a magazine last August. You said Ukrainians would never forgive you if you just gave up the fight against corruption. Never forgive you, as if you're the last best savior of this country?
Well, some people believe like that. So I don't think...
The 2% who gave you a very favorable rating last September.
You have thousands. Never since Maidan. Ever anybody had mobilized such large crowds in the street of Kiev as we did in December. And this, I accept that's all about me, but I helped to do it. And I helped to do it with a group of people, lots of good young people, lots of new faces.
But it is about you, because you told a magazine last August, you said, if I gave up, that would mean I'm just like everybody else.
Absolutely.
And all my life I've tried not to be just like everybody else. So it is all about you.
No, it's not being like this. Look, this country...
Lots of politicians talk about their vision. You talk about you.
In this country...
What you want to be.
I just made a film which is all about Ukraine's future. Ukraine can make it. I talk about new political system, new economy, new energy system, new tourist industry of Ukraine. This is all about Ukraine. My legacy in Georgia is all about results. I would like to create...
We'll come on to that a little later. Let's talk about your time as governor of Odessa.
Yes.
In 2015, Mr. Poroshenko offered you the job of governor of Odessa region. And you went with a reformist zeal. Let's put it like that. You said people expected with a real revolution comes real change, but we had the revolution that basically didn't produce real change. Now is the time to resolve this. And then 18 months later, you say you've been sabotaged and you leave.
Because that's the fact of life.
And you didn't expect this. This is known as one of the most notorious areas of corruption in Ukraine, in a very corrupt country in Ukraine.
Exactly.
And you just gave it 18 months and then gave up.
Exactly, because when I went there, we all believed, the team that I brought with me, we all believed that Poroshenko would have interest in supporting us, that and the Kiev elite would have stake in supporting
us. You thought it would be that easy?
No, really? I thought that they had, it all started nicely and well. It all started beautiful. People brought this government and Poroshenko with 54%. We had Maidan. And with all the criticisms we had of them and with all the skepticism we had of them, we still thought, this time it will be different. Why? Because it was after Maidan. Because that's the European choice.
But you know how entrenched corruption is in a country like this.
You start somewhere.
And you only gave it 18. That's all you were prepared to give it. Maxim Aristavi, Ukrainian civil rights advocate, said last year, he quit early, just blaming everything and everyone else for not achieving anything during that period.
Well, that's not exactly right. We didn't achieve anything. We built the road that had not been built for 40 years. We had it built. We brought a lot of new people for the customs. So the first time in history of that city of Odessa, customs, police, and prosecutors were not corrupt. That's quite an achievement. Now, I would have preferred to build a new Singapore there, or indeed a new Batum. It didn't exactly work. That needs another level of support. But we showed the people the difference, and I think that's some kind of legacy. Even if I'm totally unhappy with it, and I'm not satisfied with my performance, but we could achieve as much as we could.
Let me put it to you, Mr. Saakashvili. The trouble was the job wasn't high profile enough, wasn't big enough, didn't have enough power, and you're still hungry for power, aren't
The job of Odessa governor was very high profile in Ukraine because it was the front line of fighting for against corruption and for unity of Ukraine.
But you told a Western journalist in December, last December, that you had your eyes on a role in a future government, ideally as prime minister.
You're
hungry for power.
Let me put very plain. When Poroshenko offered me twice to become prime minister, I declined. I declined because I thought it would be window dressing. I declined because he wanted me to use my popularity at that moment to kind of do this PR stunt for him. But I thought that it would not, when I asked him, would I be allowed to have my ministers? Would I be allowed to have a call for new elections together with him if we wanted a real change? He said, absolutely not. Then I said, I cannot take the job. But of course, if we have new elections, if we have change of elite, if we have new people, And if people want me to serve as prime minister, and 34% at the, according to these polls I showed, they support it. Yeah, why not? I am really questioning the responsibility.
How did you think you were going to make progress in this country?
Yeah.
By making serious allegations constantly against powerful people? You think after you've called everyone else a crook, and everybody says you're a crook, and you call them liars, you think you're going to be the last man standing here? It becomes a joke, isn't it? You said Poroshenko is a thief who is mega corrupt and is plundering the whole of Ukraine.
We
will go to Parliament and call for his impeachment. Serious charges, but you laid not one shred of evidence.
Well,
in
there
the
is
public
more
domain.
There is, well, there's plenty of evidence.
No, but you say this. Don't do the hard
look,
work. You don't do the analysis. You don't do the conversations.
Did.
You know, you haven't.
We did.
You haven't put it out there in the public domain. Everybody says this about
we
you.
We just had a bunch of big scandals, very well documented, about president abusing his power, about president of using his office, taking part in money laundering, reinforcing the oligarchs, having direct conflict of
interest.
Where's
the proof that you could take to a court?
Yeah.
Where's the proof?
To which court? The court that they fully
control.
To full courts that fully control. By the way,
to
we
any
are.
Courts?
Look, we have lots of lawsuits against them in every court, but as a rule, we are losing. The legal system in this country does work. Oligarchs control political power, media, prosecutors, courts, police system.
But every time you make a major allegation like this and you don't provide the evidence, you devalue your own currency.
No, I think we are getting more and more support of the people. People are getting awareness. I think we saw in Romania what had happened when institutions had failed people. I think Ukrainians were no worse than Romanians. I think they will as well as tell eventually through peaceful protests force institutions to work to perform their duty and to get rid of the corrupt oligarchy.
You're using these allegations the way a lot of politicians use slogans. You somehow don't feel the need to prove them, but you just call them all crooks.
In Ukraine's case,
you call them all crooks.
In Ukraine's case, evidence is everywhere, and unfortunately, almost entire elite of Ukraine are.
But that's almost a cliche. That's almost a cliche.
Let's face the truth.
You think that gets rid of the need to actually provide solid evidence?
We have totally solid evidence, but the worst.
Put it out there.
The biggest evidence Ukraine has. Ukraine is not growing. The economy is stagnating. Ukraine has become the poorest GDP per capita country in Europe.
And on the strength of that, you tell them they're all crooks.
Yeah, and as a result, this is a result of these corrupt elites.
That wouldn't stand up in any court of law.
You have president owning, becoming partner to biggest oligarchs on electricity monopoly. Then he raises electricity prices, and then he benefits from it directly.
You knew this before you took on the job.
Absolutely, no.
You knew this. You knew he was an oligarch. You knew he hadn't sold his chocolate business, even though he'd promised to do this.
Well,
you had no illusions, or you should have had no illusions about what you were getting into. You gave it 18 months, then you call them all crooks. You throw up your hands, and then you walk out.
Well, nothing is static. When we started, we both believed that he had unique chance to become somebody else. Yes, he had all these corrupt backgrounds and connections. But on the other hand, people gave him mandate. And we believe that initially he started quite well. He brought some young people. He allowed us to have some autonomy. He allowed us to create an national anti-corruption bureau. He allowed to have transparent loan purchases. There are certain, he allowed us to create national anti-corruption bureau and also to create new police force as an embryo. So there were a number of steps taken in right direction. Not everything was so bad. But at a certain moment, this all came into conflict with his personal interests and personal oligarchs. And then he had a choice. And unfortunately, he made absolutely wrong choice. He decided, well, if I had been in his place, I would never have opted for Forbes list of billionaires.
Okay.
I would have opted to become a historic figure. He would rather be in Forbes list of billionaires than to be a historic figure.
Saakashvili,
that's the difference of vision.
Mr. Saakashvili, you claimed in December that a presidential emissary had visited you, said all your problems would go away, current accusations of receiving illegal funds, all that. If you would simply criticize the opposition politician, Julia Tymoshenko, and stop criticizing him. I was told my troubles would be over if I agreed to these things.
That's exactly
I would get
right.
my passport back in 5 minutes. But when you were asked for the name of the emissary, you wouldn't give it. The one detail that would have substantiated your story, you couldn't provide.
Well, that's because that's basically the person that I didn't want to. Because
why not?
Because he wasn't to be blamed for it. He was.
No, but it gives you credibility. And if you don't give the name, you have no credibility with the story.
Every action after that proved that he was right. After that, everything that they menaced me with happened.
Anyone know that you didn't just make up
the
story?
Look, because before they told me, we will go after you. will create so-called compromise on you, will put it on television, we will.
But you're still here.
We will.
You're still here.
Yes, we will.
You're not under arrest.
We will arrest you and we'll throw you out of the country.
You're always saying the courts are fixed here. The courts actually refused to put you under house
arrest.
So it isn't that fixed.
Judge, exceptional judge who said that all the evidence against me is fake, that it's all empty, that I should be let set free, and that
there you are, justice in Ukraine.
There's one person, and she was immediately dismissed. Right now, she's facing.
And you're free to talk. You're free to wander around.
She's stateless
as you are, but you're free to be here.
They haven't
put you on a plane to Georgia,
because
do.
I still have official paper.
Which they could do.
They did it with some of my people, but I'm something else. They put several groups of Georgian back on their head, and with special flights. We freed the separate instances of special flights, they sent people away. And I'm somebody else. When I was in prison, in KGB prison here, 50,000 people took to the streets and went actually to my prison walls. That was quite a message to the government. That's why I think it also influenced the judge. It really showed it that I'm not alone and people are standing by. That's what matters, ultimately.
Let's talk about Georgia, if we may.
Sure.
January the 5th, in absentia, court convicted you of abuse of power, gave you a 3-year jail term. They say that in 2008 you misused your presidential power to pardon four police officers convicted of the murder of a banker, Sandro Giovgliani, and that the pardons were part of a deal to cover up evidence surrounding the killing.
Yes. Well, look.
You say that's a lie.
No. Nobody has ever tried in modern history presidents for pardoning. You remember Bill Clinton, pardoning his...
It's not just about pardoning, it's about whether you covered up evidence surrounding the killing.
Nobody has ever... The Constitution of Georgia makes it absolutely unlimited right for president to pardon, that first. Second, these guys served the term and they were pardoned together with 133 other military officers.
Yeah, but there were holes.
Huge holes in the case.
In 2011, the European Court of Human Rights slammed the entire investigation and implicated you in a cover-up, didn't it?
No,
it said it was struck by how the different branches of state power, the Ministry of the Interior, the Public Prosecutor's Office, the Prisons Department, the Domestic Courts, and the President of Georgia all acted in concert in preventing justice from being done. That's a huge allegation against you.
At the same time, the European Court of Human Rights just last December had said on the case against my former prime minister who is in prison that he's basically a hostage to the fact that they were looking for some kind of evidence against me, and because they refused to provide it, it was a purely political case. The government of Georgia have hired 10 best world investigators, like retired ones.
You were president at the time.
This government of Georgia that's controlled by biggest private shareholder.
But this is 2011.
Yes, but let me tell you about what
happened. You were still president.
Yes, exactly. But let me tell you what's happening now.
I know, but let's not get away from what happened then. There was a huge outcry in Georgia about this.
Yes, European court had criticized this, but on the other hand, president had unlimited right to pardon, and this case is purely political. And I'll tell
you suggestion was, Mr. Saakashvili, that Giovgliani was murdered on the orders of one of your senior colleagues, and that four policemen were persuaded to take the hit in return for big money and early release.
No, the people who murdered, who got it in this manslaughter history, they were convicted and they served big part of their
term. They were convicted in a trial where the judge didn't even ask about their motives.
But you know the same
judge... The trial was faulty
The same judge, this very same judge, has been used in cases against my government members already by this government. So judges, unfortunately...
And the mother of the victim was threatened and told to stay silent, offered money if she stayed silent, and told she would be silenced if she opened her mouth. This case was dirty through and through, wasn't it?
Mr. Sebastian, look. Country I took as a Georgia was a failed country, way back then. You wouldn't expect me to turn a failed country with no budget, with no functioning institutions, that turned, which turned into a very performing, brilliant case of success and reforms, but it couldn't have been turned into absolute perfect liberal...
So that was an excuse for preventing justice from being done?
Liberal democracy.
That's an excuse for preventing justice from being done.
English-style judicial system, our judicial system, had been failing. this is true. I would admit it.
The accusation is that you prevented justice from being done.
No, but it's just not true. Our judicial system was weak then, and our judicial system is even worse now.
But your human rights record wasn't that good during the time you were there,
You would not expect...
Your crackdown on the press, the Imedi TV station that your security forces raided in 2007, physically abusing journalists, destroying their equipment.
But still it went back to the air.
You put your own commissar in power, the station for 5 years.
It still stays there. It hates me. There are plenty of other stations. The main result of my work is in a region where nobody quits on their own. When I had full power, much more than Poroshenko ever I would have here, I quit on my own through elections. I gave peaceful transition.
Are you claiming credit simply for doing what any normal president in a normal country should have done?
Not in our region. You look around in our region, nobody does that.
Tito Giaparizzi, your former foreign minister, said it was clear by the end of your first term you were using your authority to create an unshakable power fiefdom. He called your style of ruling ultimately authoritarian. It was, wasn't it?
Tito Giaparizzi was working for the biggest private shareholder of Gazprom, even if he's an oligarch.
That doesn't mean he was wrong.
There are plenty of other people who said
the same thing, including the human rights organizations.
We moved Georgia from the worst place of doing business to being one of the best, from 127th position to 9th position.
You spied on your own people comprehensively.
It's not true.
You had a so-called dirty archive full of sex tapes featuring politicians, activists, and well-known Georgia stockpiled to use as
blackmail.
Nobody
has ever stockpiled. Don't repeat the bullshit of Russian propaganda. Nobody has ever produced it.
Nobody has ever produced evidence of it.
It was all made up. It was made up first by Russian propaganda and repeated by biggest private shareholder of Gazprom. I specifically prohibited to put any evidence on private life. This is very important for me personally because that's exactly what they've been using against me under previous government. That's what they're trying to use against me in Ukraine. I just hate those things. In Georgia, Georgia's system was far from ideal, but Georgia had the best reforms in terms of corruption in this region. Georgia had the best far-performing institutions, short of course, best judicial system, which wasn't there. Georgia had Georgia's government, when they're talking about fiefdom, they had 10 best investigators in the world.
So were looking for my offshores, for my accounts, for my something.
They couldn't find anything because
they
don't exist.
So one of your co-leaders of the so-called Rose Revolution, Nino Bourjanadze, said in 2012, Georgia had become like the Bolshevik system.
You know
if
who
you
she
criticize
is? She
the
is
regime,
the biggest...
you're an enemy of the people.
Tim, she is the biggest admirer of Putin. She is the biggest friend of Putin.
That's a smear, isn't it?
No, but no.
Just because she said there were questions to answer about the war with Russia in 2008, you hit back and said, people who say the time for questions will come are traitors and Russian spies.
This is not my terminology first.
You smeared her.
I never called people like that traitors and spies. Traitors is not my term. But in her case, after war in Georgia, after Russian invasion into Georgia, she went with Putin and basically was stood in front of Russian military parade, troops that killed her compatriots.
She doesn't deny that she talked to Putin.
She's the person...
But to smear her as a Russian agent, without any proof at all.
She stands next to Putin, calls her role model, says what Putin wants to do.
She never called him a role model.
Of course she did. It's an insult to compare Saakashvili to Putin because Putin is
a role model. She wasn't the only one criticizing your handling of the war.
Yeah, but she's not the right person.
She wasn't the only one. The EU criticized your handling of the war.
Well...
They said that they delivered a damning indictment of you, accusing your administration of effectively starting the war.
No, that's not what they said.
They said, through a penchant, for acting in the heat of the moment.
That's what they said about you in 2009.
No,
that's not what they said. They said that Russian troops were the first to enter Georgian territory, but the big action was started by our response. And you know, I would see any other president in the world not responding to foreign army entering the territory.
And they said the investigation decided that both sides bore responsibility for the conflict. That they did say. Which flatly contradicts your version.
No, the thing is that small country Georgia was invaded by 100 times bigger country with Russia. And every time There is a trend to blame the victim, because then international community had to do something about it. But despite the fact, after Ukraine had happened, after that we have so many much evidence gathered after that, it's all painful, obvious what was
the
happening.
The international community did help you, and now you're looking, here you are in Ukraine,
yes.
You're looking for help from the international community.
Yeah, of course,
and
always.
You say you'll fight to the end. Fight for what? Stay out of jail?
No,
I can't, for
God's sake, I can take plane tonight and leave it and stay out of the jail. I can go to any country.
So why
in
don't you? Why don't
because
you?
I have my
fight
here.
Because you're enjoying it. You're having the time
no,
of
because,
your life.
No, because
and I've, you're different from everybody else. We come back to what you said. I don't want to be the same as everybody
because
else.
Because oligarchs are winning in Georgia, in Moldova, in Ukraine, all around the place, and we cannot give him such an easy ride. We cannot give him such an easy victory. These guys are humiliating people. They are corrupt. They are killing the prospects and future for this country. Ultimately, they will blow up these countries because these countries will disintegrate.
I cannot
sit somewhere in Netherlands and look at it quietly. I just cannot do it.
Mikheil Saakashvili, good to have you on the program.
Thank you for
Thanks
inviting me.
Thanks very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.